is Earl Nightingale. Welcome to a recorded sales seminar I know you'll find interesting, exciting, practical, and productive. As you listen to these tapes, you'll feel as though you're actually taking part in the stimulating seminar sessions. When questions are asked, you'll be answering them, mentally taking part right along with the recorded participants. Now, your reactions, thinking, and involvement will reinforce the hundreds of good ideas you'll want to take away to apply to your own selling. Fred Herman is a master salesman. You'll discover that early in your tapes. He's also a masterful sales trainer. That you'll learn early, too. For over a quarter of a century, Fred's delivered forceful, common-sense answers to everyday sales problems for firms like General Motors, Bank of America, Bell Telephone, Western Airlines, hundreds of others. Now, don't forget, what you get out of this program depends entirely on you. You must listen to the tapes, you must do the exercises, and you must complete the assignments. No one can do that for you. And, of course, you will get the benefits. You will get the improved performance, and you will get the increased sales. No one can do that for you either. Now, how can you go about becoming the master of these right principles of persuasion? There are four simple steps. First, listen to the entire session at your leisure, in your car, while you're driving to and from work, at home, or in the office. Second, listen again. This time, if it's convenient, use the retention worksheets in your progress guide. Make notes as you move through the session to personalize the ideas to you. Third, listen again. And this time, as you do, complete the retention review and other assignments for each session. Fourth, listen to each session as often as you can. Use repetitive involvement to help you build habit patterns that will enable you to respond by reflex to selling situations that may now give you trouble. If you'll do this consistently, you'll soon find yourself making more sales, no matter how good you are now, bigger sales and better sales every time. So now let's take a little preview of our first session. Salesmen are not born. Of course, it's safe to say that salesmen are born like everybody else. They're not born as full-grown, polished, successful salesmen, however, any more than doctors or lawyers or engineers are born ready to practice. The requirements of any profession are basic and include continued study and application. And here's how we'll pursue our study. In this cassette, you'll learn about the four essential factors for success in selling: making calls, making good calls, on good prospects, with the right attitude. You'll learn how this can be done through planned selling, selling yourself, talking to the people who can say yes, and making liberal use of referrals. You'll also learn how important it is to like yourself, to be pleased with your performance. And you'll find out how you can develop this performance by having a selling plan, recognizing that it's your responsibility to help prospects decide, and by being creative in approaching your prospects. A lot to digest in one session? Yes, I suppose it is. But that's exactly why we suggest you listen to these tapes repeatedly, so you'll be able to really master them and put every one of these important selling skills to work for you. But now let's get started. Let's cut to Fred Herman leading the seminar on using creative selling. Salesmen are not born.
We're going to start out the session with a little quiz contest in which there'll be some cash prizes awarded. His cash prize amount of $1, $10, $20, $50, $100, and $1,000. Oh, it's real $1,000, all right. Well, the way this works is this. I will announce the cash award, and then I'll ask a question. And whoever in the group can answer the question within a 10-second time limit will get that particular cash award. Now, I need an honest fella to keep time for me. Got an honest fella? Skip, you'll keep time. All right, fine. 10 seconds. Watch it. Soon as... Yell time real loud. Okay. For the $1 bill, the question is, who was Jim Thorpe's coach?
Pop Warner.
We've got it over here first, I think. Got it back there. Would you come up and get the dollar, please? Are you going to save this or keep it for a souvenir?
Keep it for
a
souvenir.
I'll give you a check. For the $10 bill, the question is, who was Einstein's arithmetic teacher in the third grade? Okay, thanks. For the $20 bill, the question is, who was Paderewski's piano teacher when he was 6 years old?
Time.
Okay, fine. Well, we just as well knock this quiz off, because from this point on, the questions get harder. But don't anybody go away. I'll give you a chance to win the $1,000 at the end of this session here when we get right to the end of it. I did this for a particular reason. It's very important as we invest this time together in some of the skills of persuasion and selling that we would be on the right basis with each other, you and me. Pop Warner could not have competed in any athletic event with Jim Thorpe. He didn't have the physical build, he didn't have the stamina, and he was in a different generation, but he helped Jim Thorpe get more out of Jim Thorpe. Somebody taught Einstein, 2 times 2 is 4. I don't know if you can find that name in the history book, but whoever it was pretty important what Einstein ultimately achieved. Somebody probably forced Paderewski to play the piano scales when he was a kid. Didn't have the genius, didn't have the emotional drive, didn't have the talent that Paderewski had, but this person was pretty important in helping Paderewski to reach more of his potential. So my point is this: who I am, what I've achieved, is not really important. What's important, as we share this time together, do I have some ideas that are going to help you to be more effective working with your customers in the sales profession? That's what I'm really here for, right?
Right.
I believe we have a problem sometimes in the selling profession. It is possible that we might try to throw too many ideas at a salesman at one time, and then he can't remember the idea long enough to use it face-to-face with a customer. And no idea of selling is of any value unless you use the idea. I was reading a book the other day that man had written over 32 million laws since the beginning of recorded history. And went on to say if we would follow just 10 fundamental laws, we wouldn't need any of the 32 million. Anybody guess what those 10 fundamental laws are?
Ten commandments.
That's exactly right. What I'd like to do in our relationship is to take this whole mass of selling psychology and mechanics of selling and boil it down to those few basic rules. If you know what these are and can do them effectively, it will give you better control of the selling interview. Some of the things we're going to cover, you've already heard before. They're so basic, actually, you could find the book I mentioned just a few seconds ago, the Holy Bible. But I believe there are a lot of good ideas out of this book that apply to selling. One verse in particular I know, it says, "Seeking ye shall find." That's not bad for prospecting, right? There's another verse in here that says, "Ask and it'll be given unto you. Ask and you'll receive." That's a pretty good closing technique. There's another verse in here I think of occasionally when I work with some sales groups. It's, "Why seek ye the living among the dead?" There are a number of chapters in the Bible that are all almost actually complete sales format. In the 10th chapter of St. Luke, this is where Jesus tells the disciples how to spread the gospel. That's kind of a selling job, right?
Right.
Well, here's a man who really understood sales psychology, both from the standpoint of the salesman and from the standpoint of the sales manager. Second verse, 10th chapter, St. Luke, he says, "The harvest is truly great, but the laborers are few." I asked a sales manager the other day, "How many salesmen work for you?" And he said, "About half." Well, that's not a bad average when you come right down to it. There's a reason for this, and it's actually in the third verse of 10th chapter of St. Luke, where it says this: "Behold, I send you out as lambs among wolves." Selling is not an easy job. I think the selling profession requires as much knowledge as any other profession. I know it requires just as much effort, or maybe more, than other professions. And I know it requires a great deal of courage, perhaps more courage than many of the other professions. Because I hope this doesn't come as a surprise or shock to anybody here, but when you go out to make sales calls, they don't always say yes.
Oh.
Would you believe it? Sometimes they say no.
I've heard it.
Now, if a salesman gets enough of those no answers in a row, his tendency is to gradually turn that rejection away from his product and proposition and turn it on to whom?
Exactly.
And he says, "Boy, there must be something wrong with me." Can somebody tell me what's the first law of nature?
The law of
self-preservation.
Self-preservation, that's right. What's the second law? In the group the other day, some smart aleck said sex. That's all part of the same thing. One of the things we have to preserve is our ego. That's the way we feel about ourselves. Now, if you get these no answers and you start saying there must be something wrong with me, it's kind of hard to preserve your ego. But some salesmen very cleverly figure out a way to do this. Just don't make any calls. No rejection. You know why they have picture shows open downtown in the daytime?
Fine. For sale.
That's for sale. I know, because I see them there. There's another symptom you can sometimes see of this fear factor of going out and exposing yourself to rejection. It's where a salesman might have prospect cards, and he's holding them in front of him, studying them, and lays them out in different piles on his desk after a lot of study with each card, gets them all laid out, and then you'll notice he'll pick them back up and start all over again. This is called the shuffling blues. Now, that'll keep you from making calls for a long period of time. But if you'll accept with me that you got to make some calls to get started, then let's take a look at the second factor for success in selling. It's to make good calls. This involves, I believe, two things. Number one would be this plan selling, where you have a plan that you follow so that no matter what happens, you get off the track, you can get back on the track, and you have control of the sales presentation and the response of the customer. It almost becomes a reflex. You see, any boxer who had to think of what punch he was going to throw, what would happen to him? Can't get clobbered. But there's another factor that's involved in making good calls, and it's a factor called selling yourself. So I'd like to just bring out...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.